I want to thank you all for staying towards the end of the day on a Friday afternoon like this. I know we're the only thing that stands between you and an adult refreshment later this afternoon, so we'll finish right on time. I think you would agree with me that the previous panels have been quite fascinating in the issues that they've explored. We're extraordinarily lucky this afternoon because I know both of the three panels extremely well, and you really do have sort of a who's who real sort of titans of the field who have been writing in this area, practicing in the area for a significant amount of time and have a great deal of experience. I hope you've noticed that the theme of the conference has what we refer to as the geek wonk bridge. And that in order for you to approach this issue, you need geeks and wonks. And I was very happy to hear NYU has now announced a new center of bringing the attorneys together with the, quote, IT engineering scientific people, because that's what we think is the multidisciplinary approach to this problem. So we're going to start off with Elizabeth. You have her bio in your notes, and she's going to do sort of a set the where we've been, which she was involved in when she was both a general counsel for a number of the three-lettered agencies, and as a former dean, she's been quite involved in these issues. And then we're going to move from the, as we would say, from a wonk to a super geek. We're going to have Stephen, who's going to sort of give his perspective from that engineering issue of what the future is and what have been the longstanding problems in this arena. And then batting third will be Paul. And I think you all know Paul from his extraordinary blogging and the books he's written and his experience in public policy. So we think this is the cherry at the top of the cake that we've put together for the full day. And we hope you enjoy it. And with that, Elizabeth, can you sort of set the trend for us?
If you'll hand me my thoughts, Harvey, I'll do that.
I'd be happy to.
Actually, I was subject to what might have been a hacking attempt last night, and I lost all my notes. And so we're just going to do it this way.
They're now in Mandarin, apparently.
They're being delivered as I speak. So what I really wanted to do was make this a little bit more personal, and I hope you'll indulge me, but what can you do? You know, when Harvey asked me would I speak on this topic, my heart sank because, frankly, I hate cybersecurity. And notwithstanding that I think what Sam and Zach and Dean Morrison and the ABA has done in making this important topic the center of this conference, you should know that it's always struck me as in the too hard pile. And this afternoon I realized why that was as I heard the third panel and just loved the conversation about, well, the strategy and trial and da-da, you know, and this rule. And I thought, isn't this, this is what I really live for. So when I arrived at NSA, for a lot of reasons, I didn't pay a whole lot of attention to computer security. Now, this was way back before many of you were reading the New York Times or whatever it is you read today. It was in 1985. And it turned out that at that time, they had just concluded several important things. So this really is a, maybe I should have been the first speaker, this is really kind of a historical quick review, if you will, of 30 years. And what they had learned, I think, however, is relevant to the conversation today because several things had happened. One was that they had concluded, they being not just NSA but the Defense Department, that it was a wise strategy to take more advantage of the civilian-military complex. And rather than continue to support communications in a totally closed military system, which of course had to be paid for, rather to spread it out into the civilian sector made good sense. And I think someone mentioned that 80, was it perhaps the general, or perhaps you, 85% of military defense communications today are out there on that private sector. I recall at NSA, I had four phones in addition to the outside line, and there was one phone that sat on my shelf. And in my 5.5 years as general counsel, it rang one time. I never quite knew what that phone was about. It was a wrong number. But in any event, the point was that something else had happened that allowed this, and it was really the advance of encryption technology, and in particular, public key encryption technology, which was allowing them this kind of a migration. The other thing that happened, and this now kind of is where I enter the story, is that The then deputy director, and there were three deputy directors who were really the power brokers at the time, one of them named Dick Lord. We often refer to the Lord. But it wasn't the Lord, it was rather Walter Dealey, who had moved from the Signals Intelligence Directive to what was to be renamed the Information Security Directive. Now, keep in mind that NSA actually has three missions, and this is something that perhaps not everybody has thought about, but it's both the maker and breaker of codes. Of course, it gathers electronics information, and I hope I'm well within my non-disclosure, what will we say, arena here, but also does communications security. And so here the point was that it was becoming clear even then that communications were no longer simply telephony, as we come to understand them, but rather that they were increasingly involving computers as well. And the person they put in charge then was one, as I mentioned, Walter G. Dealey. Not a lot said about Walter, but something to know about him was that I think he could have been called a messianic maniac. He was once said to have chased an employee down the hall with a blunt instrument because he didn't like what the person had said or done. He was truly unusual.
And we have the statute of limitations on that issue.
Very passionate, and perhaps that's really what it took. Because to move a bureaucracy as large as our government, and oh, by the way, in case you were wondering, it's really a loose confederation of warring tribes. Let's get the governmental structure clear. You need that kind of passion. And what Walter did then was to persuade the Reagan administration that we needed to have a coherent policy for information security. And so he persuaded them to promulgate something called NSDD 145. Who's heard of NSDD 145? Holly McMahon, I know you have because I told you yesterday. All right. Really, it obviously made a huge hit. But what it did do is what we've been talking about. It created a coherent policy. Now, the interesting thing about this policy was that NSA, of course, shall we say, is not exactly prepared to deal with policy formulation and implementation. Indeed, it's somewhat, you might even say, hermetically sealed as an agency. And it's been trained that its role is not policy, but rather simply producing information. And so I would guess that probably you'll agree that it made some mistakes. But the mistakes are interesting ones because they continue to be the ones we debate today. So the first was, well, who should be in charge of this national structure that would promulgate the kind of rules, regulations, policies, and authorities to ensure that we had secure communications in the United States? Can you guess who the person or who the entity was? The DOD was to be the manager, and the executive agent was NSA. Well, on the one hand, that made a lot of sense because even today, the technology that we're talking about is most present. The greatest competency, I think everyone would agree, is at NSA. I would drop a footnote, however, and tell you that our colleagues at places like Google and Microsoft don't think that the computer capabilities at NSA are quite so flashy as once they were. I would not know about that. But in any event, certainly NSA is where the most powerful technology resides, and that remains then part of the tension as to why we can't find the right entity to put in charge even today, because while in those days NIST was a contender and is still today, of course now we also have Department of Homeland Security, it was generally, I think, pretty much the consensus view that they really couldn't hold a candle to NSA. Interestingly, there's a very fine article by the Office of Technology Assessment, which was a congressional office, that pretty much described all of this in 1985. Very thoughtful piece. For its pains, Newt Gingrich lined it out of the budget, and so it no longer exists. It was a very fine office that really did provide some of the kind of technological, I think, insight and advice that Congress could have used, but it doesn't exist anymore. In any event, that was the problem. Well, on the other hand, the civilian agencies, and I'm not yet speaking of the private sector, were horrified. They did not want to be swept under the military, if you will, structure. And there were several reasons for that. I mean, there's always, of course, protecting your own turf, but I think realistically they felt that the optics of that were not good. It was kind of a militaristic power grab. But I think importantly, too, they were concerned that in the standard setting authority that NSDD 145 gave to NSA, they would be held to a very costly and high standard appropriate for the military, but not something that domestic agency budgets could withstand. And so they resisted heavily, and they were they had allies in all of this in the private sector. And so notwithstanding Walter Dealey's incredible passion and histrionics, indeed, I was the subject of some of those on more than one occasion when I reminded him that having four senators was not enough to pass a bill. he was not amused at that bit of information sharing. The thing really fell into, I suppose we could say, oblivion. But as I've mentioned, I think some of the issues that were raised at that time have continued until the present day. In fact, in the attachment to your program materials, you'll find a synopsis of the laws that touch on this area, and I think there's something like 50 mentioned. The fact is there still is not a coherent statutory framework. Well, I'm moving along, and lest I occupy the entire time allocated to this panel, I'll just touch on some things that happened as we went forward.
Just be yourself.
You're right. among the things that stood out in my mind that were really, I think, missteps that took us not just in the wrong direction but created kind of antibodies that prevented us moving in the right direction was the way in which encryption policy was handled. Now, encryption had always been something, at least when I arrived at NSA, that was very, very carefully guided and controlled. Indeed, we would use the Patent Secrecy Act on occasion during my tenure to classify an encryption development. But as you all now know, encryption technology has become the bedrock on which all of what we're talking about rests. And so there was a major shift. In fact, I was interested reviewing this remarkable book called Code by Lessig. He talks about encryption technology as possibly the most significant technological development in the last 1,000 years. So that tells you something about what we're really going through here in terms of, a major shift. Well, NSA, for its part, was really, and I suppose anybody would have been caught a little short, having for years been the source of all cryptography, the largest employer of mathematicians still today in the United States. And so they were understandably initially very concerned at the idea that suddenly strong encryption would be out there blocking what they were chartered to do. And so one response was the Clipper chip. Now, who remembers the Clipper chip? Well, many more do. We're getting closer to the time, you know, when lives and being were. And here we had a backdoor idea. Well, this was very unpopular, need I say. But a little vignette, just to kind of show you what the personnel at NSA are really like. I remember being at a meeting, and one person said, what? We would be able to access these encrypted communications and read the mail of U.S. persons? Why, he was shocked. I tried to explain to him that, you know, what we can do isn't necessarily what we do. We have rules, laws, regulations, and so forth to govern it. But I think that's kind of an interesting reaction. Well, so we move on, and we find then that we continue this problem. It's too costly to replicate NSA. We know we need coherent policies across the government, and we don't have them. What is to be done, in the immortal words of V.I. Lenin? Well, two responses, and perhaps one of them still kind of coming forward even now. The first is the notion of an Economy Act transfer. Now, there's a statute you all have tripping on your lips, right? You know exactly what I mean when I say Economy Act transfer, do Economy Act transfer. That simply allows moving the capability of an agency into another agency, but operating under its authority. And so this was, in fact, what we would do from time to time in response to requests, particularly from the FBI. But there again, that is the device by which some of this technology powerhouse at NSA that I'm talking about could be made available to a broader set of agencies. Of course, the issue for NSA was always revealing sensitive technologies. The other thing that increasingly, I think, has developed, and this may be the way through this problem of we have technology on the defense side that is not equaled on the civilian side, and we don't want to have a military, a defense-controlled structure here, is the notion of an FFRDC. Who knows what an FFRDC is? A show of hands. Oh, good. Wow. Do you know, in the number of people I've talked to about FFRDCs, I've had like two hands go up. So an FFRDC
is
really...
I work for one.
A good. There we go. A federally funded research and development corporation. And this is the vehicle, then, that the government uses to expand its own capabilities. Then a good example would be the RAND Corporation.
Or MITRE.
Or MITRE. I didn't mention MITRE because I have
Homeland Security Institute.
There you go. All right. We all have conflicts of interest. So these are folks who then bring really, we hope, world-class, gold-standard capacity in some of the technical areas that the government may not be able to afford or to hold people or what will you. And so NIST has decided that it's going to see whether it can't have an FFRDC, which would expand its capacities, its technical capacities, and use these then to populate and support a center that would bring the private sector in to discuss, develop, and promulgate strong technologies. We'll see whether that's really the solution to the problem or not. Well, I want to kind of bring this to something of a close and say that one of the reasons that I think this is a wonderful topic for a seminar like this one, which is really Harvey's brainchild, the teaching Jurga, is that this is an area that I think law schools have not spent enough effort on, and I think lawyers have not spent enough effort on. The fact of the matter is, not only are we kind of uncomfortable with policy and certainly technology. I mean, goodness, I would have become an accountant if I could have added, subtracted, multiplied, or divided. I mean, now we're talking bits and, you know, zeros and ones. It's too hard. But the point is, for the next generation, we're going to need to have people who are trained across these disciplines, and that training is an educational process that begins with the teaching staff in higher education institutions. And so for schools like NYU, and I see back there David Delaney from Indiana University, where there's another one of these fused operations. This is the way forward, and it's something we very much must concentrate on. You would be surprised, I think, if you looked out there and counted what the fine technology institutions are. Let's name a few. Well, we've got MIT, Carnegie Mellon, I'll throw Rice in. You can go on. No law schools there. And so we have a stovepipe problem where on the one hand, the technologists think about their law, that would be natural law, in a different way than we think about our law, and we're not talking together. And so I think really this is where work, definitely big work, needs to be done. And part of that work may sound simplistic to you, but it's as profound as anything we could get to, and the general mentioned it. Words matter. And we do not have a common lexicon. And this was something I learned when I was at NSA, and it constantly bedeviled me. I had one of the three lords of the realm, as I mentioned, the director of technology, come in and say, well, you know, tapping a wire, well, wire, what am I trying to say? The optic cable isn't a wire. And I said, well, what do you mean? He said, there's no wire, there's just light. And I said, well, yeah, but, you know, kind of this is really supposed to be the same thing. Or on another occasion, the director of operations said, you know, we're the only ones that can do SIGINT. What the DEA does, they're using exactly the same technology. That is not SIGINT. And I thought, well, you know, and then we have the issue of targeting, which is a different word depending on where you are. So a common lexicon, I think, is really something necessary. And that's the kind of thing, in my judgment, that happens in the policy-rich environment of an academic institution that is fused across disciplines. I'll make one final comment, and then I promise to stop. And that is, in all of this, there's an education that has to happen of the public at large, because we're not going through just a technological or a legal change. We're going through a culture shift. And so I think our cultural anthropologist friends need to be with us. I was struck by the fact that Notre Dame recently, a woman came up to me, a PhD, member of the faculty, as a cultural anthropologist. She's written a book called Cyber Shadows, I think it's called. Her name is Carolyn Nordstrom, and it's a book about the whole cyber world from a criminal perspective. and from a cultural perspective. And it's the kind of book that every person could and probably should read, whether they're a student or not, because it would do what we've been talking about. It would, I think, sufficiently inform the average person so that they would begin to think, this is a serious threat, not just should our nation go to war, but for me and my family personally. And I think when we get to that level, we may actually begin to develop the kind of solutions, bringing our legal friends into the room again, that really can be codified and put into a legal framework where authorities, whether state, local, or federal, can begin to act on them. And until that happens, I think we are constrained to live in, frankly, a world that is kind of pre-modern, if you will, a bit anarchical. So.
Thank you, Elizabeth, for giving us a great tour of where we've been and where we may be going. We started the day with Mike Vadas, and Mike and I, when we were at the Department of Justice, we're working on PDD 62 and 63. And it's amazing how much is deja vu all over again on those issues. But we have, I think, someone who could solve these problems, which is Stephen. If you're doing the CLE, Stephen's essay is called Lawful Hacking, Using Existing Vulnerabilities for Wiretapping on the Internet. But Steve's been around this area for a little while, and I think has seen a number of iterations, and it'll be perfect for that sort of the technological geek perspective of how you perceive the issues of the future.
Right, so I'm a computer science professor. Lots of lawyers in my family, including my son, but I'm not one. I'm a computer scientist. And no, I have been around for a while. I caught my first hackers around 1971. A few miles uptown, I was working at City College of New York Computer Center. It had the computer for the City University of New York. I think the main message that I want to convey is that writing software, in particular correct software, is really, really hard. Arguably insolvable, and that's one of the things that keeps me in a job, is any of you have ever had a computer crash or an application crash or do something completely preposterous, you get that spinning beach ball when you try to go to a website, you know it's not down because able to go there again instantly. That's a symptom of buggy software. And it turns out that buggy software is what's responsible for most computer security problems. Advice like choose good passwords or use encryption, perfectly sound advice. It's also, to some extent, advice like, look under the lamppost for your keys, there's better light there. Sometimes your keys are going to be under the lamppost. Most of the time, a strong password is useful when a password file has been stolen from a service provider, which means that they've already suffered some other kind of security breach, probably due to buggy code. Use encryption. Unless you're being targeted by a government, I won't say which government, if you're using a wired network in your house, the chances of the encryption actually mattering are effectively zero. It's just a really hard thing to eavesdrop on a wired network going from your house to an ISP to a corporation. It's just a really hard problem. Yes, governments can do it, advanced hackers can do it, but unless they're targeting you, they're probably not going to. Different story in a room like this where it's all public, but to a great extent, buggy software is the problem.
And Steve, if in your home you're using a wireless network, would you make a similar statement that it's hard?
If it's a wireless network, you need cryptography to protect the wireless portion of the network. But your Wi-Fi signal, it's got a range of about 100 meters. If you live in a large rural lot, you're probably safe there, except for the car parked outside your house. Now, make no mistake about it. There have been incidents, criminal incidents, where someone has abused a neighbor's wireless or poorly encrypted wireless network. Range of child pornography raids staged because someone parked outside somebody's house and use their wireless network to download child porn. There have been incidents like that. That's why I specified a wired network. But again, that's 100 meter range for a typical wireless network, unless someone's using a strange antenna. which you can make from a Pringles can, it turns out. But and this means that, yeah, we take the national security realm. Most of you have heard the line attributed to Willie Sutton, the famous bank robber, about why he robbed banks, because that's where the money is. Intelligence agencies are going after computers today for two reasons, or three reasons. One, that's where the information is. We don't keep our information on pieces of paper in filing cabinets for the most part. We keep them on computers, ones that we hope are secure and protected, but they're computers. Two, the cryptography used today is rather hard. It's always been rather hard and really, really hard to break. AES, a NIST-endorsed standard for encryption, the NSA has stated that it's good enough for top-secret traffic if implemented and used properly. In fact, now, for the NSA to make a statement like that is itself surprising, but they have. So-called Sweet B encryption algorithms, AES with the right key length and so on, is good enough for top-secret traffic. Which means they think that no one's going to be able to break it. And the third thing is that you can hack computers. There's nothing that I've seen in the papers or about Stuxnet, about anything else, that's in any way surprising in the techniques that were used. What's surprising is that they could do it, and that, as Herb said earlier, it takes really good intelligence if you're going to launch a major attack. The thing about Stuxnet that was surprising was not that it was doable, but how much intelligence on the target environment whoever pulled it off had. And that alone speaks to an intelligence agency much more than the technical capabilities shown. So this shows up, there are a lot of implications for this. Because code is going to be insecure, you want to have as little of it as possible in security critical situations. So when CALEA was being debated before Congress over 20 years ago, I and some of my colleagues warned, you do not want to add complex code to a phone switch whose primary purpose is to make wiretaps easier, because this code will be insecure and will allow abuse. And this, in fact, has happened. There are rumors of it in the US, but there have been well-documented incidents abroad, because most developed nations have laws similar to CALEA under the generic name of lawful intercept.
So you should, Communications Law Enforcement Act was CALEA.
Requires that all phone switches have a special port that law enforcement can use to easily tap a phone. Yes, I'm sure it would be very useful. But in Athens, a wireless phone switch was discovered to have been hacked. By whom and how is not known, though there are suspicions about various intelligence agencies. And about 100 mobile phones were tapped, up to and including the prime minister's. By the way, the prime minister's phone was not in his name, it was in a relative's name. Again, see what I said about good intelligence being necessary for these high-level hacks. So it was not a surprise to any computer scientist that this should have been possible. There was a lot of code, and therefore a lot of extra insecurity. And the lawful hacking essay that Harvey alluded to, some colleagues of mine and I, Susan Landau, who's at Worcester Poly now, Matt Blaze at Penn, and one of Matt's PhD students, Sandy Clark, wrote two papers, a technical one in a technical journal, and a law and policy one in a law review, saying, okay, rather than extend CALEA to the internet, which has got technical and jurisdictional problems as well as creating huge security risks, well, there are lots of these security holes out there. Legalize hacking with explicit statutes, explicit policies, after suitable public debate. And by the way, report these holes to the vendor. It'll take them close to a year to get it fixed. And there'll always be another hole that you can use to hack in. And why do I say that? Well, you mentioned MITRE. MITRE is the custodian of a list called CVE. I think it's Common Vulnerabilities Enumeration. Every known security hole gets listed there. And there's a problem right now. They're going to have to switch from four-digit numbers for vulnerabilities this year to five-digit numbers. These are new security holes that have been found. They don't think that a four-digit number is going to suffice, because it's only September, they're already up to 6,400 compared with 7,400 for all of last year. So I think there's always going to be more security holes because our software keeps getting more and more complex. And this strikes us as better than, from a security perspective, than adding more code to every internet service. It also works in way in places where CALEA won't. Look at the original Skype architecture. There's no place to put a wiretap. I could give more examples like that. And finally, when we're dealing with the national security realm, most of the NSA's targets are not going to provide a nice, convenient port on a phone switch in Beijing or Moscow or wherever saying, okay, insert your tap here to go listen to the leadership. It's just not going to work that way. So this is a capability that the national security community, I would say, already has based on what I read in the papers.
Okay, so thank you as always, Stephen, for laying out sort of the technical issue. And Paul, part of Steve and Elizabeth's brief has been that it seems that offense is always better than defense in cyber, that we seem to have historic vulnerabilities. As one Marine used to say to me, when you look at code, it's just a lot of coastline. And Marines love coastline because it's hard to defend large coastlines for forced entries. So you've written on this. Your piece is called Governing a Distributed Network, Common Goods and Emergence. How do you see the future in this concept of where we're going and how it relates to the long-term problems of trying to teach and understand cyber and the vulnerabilities?
Al, there's a great deal of freedom in being the last one to speak, right? So I'm going to stand on my chair. I would stand on the table, except I'm not sure that it will actually hold me.
I'm not sure the chair will.
I know. I do this for three reasons. The first, of course, is that it's Friday at about 4 o'clock, and I got to wake up the crowd, right? The second is it's an homage to Robin Williams, right? Dead Poets Society. But the real reason is to suggest that...
The third reason is, can you sign a release form?
The third reason is that I suggest that we're on the cusp of a kind of a radical change in perspective, which, of course, is what Dead Poets Society on the desktop was all about. Almost everything that we've heard for the whole day has been focused on public law, the role of government in investigations, the role of the military in cyber warfare, the role of government and private sector cooperation to protect large-scale critical infrastructure. It's been a very public law, government-focused discussion, and to be honest and clear, I'm sort of talking out of both sides of my mouth because that's how I teach the class when I teach it at GW as well, at least in part because we teach it as part of a national security law LLM curriculum, and so a lot of my students are mid-career JAG officers, so you've got to focus on the government. But I think that we are right at the point of a transition forward to a time when private law will be the predominant type of law that applies to cybersecurity, and when the type of lawyers who will have practices in this area will transition from people who are military lawyers and JAG officers and criminal attorneys to people who understand commercial law, tort law, and insurance law. Why do I think that's the case? Why do I think that's going to happen? As I said, right now, our focus in terms of cybersecurity, at least as it really affects the public, is a fixation on vulnerabilities in critical infrastructure, large-scale problems. We worry about the electric grid or the transportation system or et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. We are on the edge of a transition to a time when the major predominant risks to citizens will be from personal consumer goods that are cyber-enabled. It goes by lots of names. The buzzword is the Internet of Things. But my friend David has a programmable insulin pump, and it's the neatest thing in the world because it's plugged into his iPad. He can reprogram it himself on his home Wi-Fi network. His doctor can read the readings on the golf course and, you know, more efficiently change it. And a year and a half ago, two hackers at a hacker conference in Las Vegas, DEF CON, demonstrated that the security on that very same piece of equipment was eminently crackable, and it could be modified to give perhaps a fatal, perhaps a non-fatal but extremely dangerous bolus of insulin to somebody. We are rushing down the road to a time when we will have computer chip-enabled driverless cars, refrigerators, toasters, etc. We are on the cusp, I think, of what I like, well, I don't like to, but what I think is going to be a Ford Pinto moment, a time when all of a sudden people are going to realize that the things that they are using every day are dangerous to them, in the same way that all of a sudden in 1974, I think it was, the Ford Pinto exploded onto the scene, forgive the pun, and became a source of liability, and then drove us through a process that involved both standard setting and regulation and liability to a world today in which, by and large, cars are manufactured in a much safer way, and you know, absent user error, they just don't blow up anymore, which is a very good thing. So what is it going to be like in the cyber realm? What do we think is coming? Here are some of the pieces of it. The first is standard setting. One of the speakers on, I think it was the first panel, kind of derided the NIST cybersecurity framework as a bunch of least common denominator standards. And I agree that for a lot of people who are already above that set of standards, the NIST framework doesn't really advance the ball very much. But there's a lot of people who aren't even matching that set of standards, and those public standards are soon going to become the default definition of what a reasonable man or a reasonable person would do in a tort situation, or what is a commercially reasonable set of activities for in a commercial context. We've already seen some of that developing. I think one of the most interesting legal developments of the last year is the confirmation of the Federal Trade Commission's authority under its unfair business practices law to bring lawsuits against consumer-facing organizations, the case was Wyndham Hotels, for failure to adopt adequate cybersecurity practices. And they're going to be compelled in the near term to articulate what adequate cybersecurity practices are. They may have to do it through guidance or an interpretation or perhaps a rulemaking, though the FTC has some very difficult rulemaking laws, so it probably won't be a rulemaking. And they're going to look to the NIST standards to set that forth. So we'll see some civil enforcement by government consumer regulatory agencies. We've seen tort cases already. One involved recently in the Fifth Circuit involving Heartland Payment Systems, who lost a massive quantity of personal information in a cyber breach of credit card information. And they have been subject to a lawsuit for the damages from their allegedly inadequate cybersecurity practices. They moved to dismiss, civil suit. Their motion to dismiss was denied. They settled, not surprisingly, so we've never had an adjudication. But all of a sudden, the prospect of liability, civil tort liability, commercial liability under the UCC, looms on the horizon. And then what follows from that, where liability comes, we soon find insurance. Because when you have a risk, good corporations want to offload that risk. Today we don't have a good insurance market outside of the data breach area. Why? Because we don't have enough data to rate the risk, we don't understand what it is, insurance companies can't price it. But they're going to. They're going to collect enough data to price it. There'll be standard-setting organizations that will develop standards for defining what adequate cybersecurity is and audit compliance with those standards. And in the end, I suspect that 10 years from now, when we have this conference again here at NYU, instead of a bunch of public law lawyers up here at the table, you'll have a bunch of private law lawyers who specialize in the intricacies of the definition of an incident under insurance contracts and treaties for payment by reinsurers out of London to the primary insurers here in New York. Or tort lawyers who will have 14 common law cases about what the reasonable standard of care is for cybersecurity for people who hold the personal information of medical practitioners. And that'll be different, probably, than that for commercial data. And we'll have an entire culture of this law that will develop kind of organically, and I think a little more nimbly than the more turgid and slow-moving government processes that we've heard about so far. And in those 10 years, I will have reinvented myself from the public lawyer that I am, that's my background, to where I actually think the law is going. And instead of teaching public law, I'll have a private law class at GW. And that's what I see in the future.
So, thank you. My father used to always say, all roads lead to Lloyd's. So, on that idea, which is that you have a finite number of ways to regulate inside our system. As Paul alluded to, either we standardize it, and we standardize it with regulation, or what we do is we sue, and we use liability, and we use lawyers to discipline entities. And the Wyndham case, by the way, is for the CLE. That is your first case in panel one that we actually have included in the materials for you to look at. And then once you have, as Paul alluded to, then we have insurance, and we have risk, and that's how we mediate it. And the fourth level, though, you didn't mention that we sometimes use, is we use the tax code, right? We always do incentives and disincentives to the
subsidies
tax code.
Subsidies.
Those are usually the four big hammers that we have in the system. Now, what's interesting is, normally when you teach, even in major public policy institutes, given cyber, it has both the technical side and it has the policy side and legal side. So the question I pose to you is that, as Stephen alluded to, we always say that what makes cyber complicated is that first, there's always software problems. We haven't been able to resolve the software. So I always say, how many of you use the Microsoft patch, the first Tuesday every month that you actually employ it? Raise your hands. Right, so I usually say, very rarely do you spend so much money on a product that you know, and I have friends at Microsoft, that you know doesn't work, except if you drive Jaguars. The second issue is you have a problem with the hardware. We have hardware liabilities. Then we have what we call carbon units, human beings, that we have focused now on insider threat problems, both in public and the private sector. And the fourth that was alluded to earlier in the first panel was the ISPs, that what we ride on the networks. So if that's all correct, that you have those four vulnerabilities, how do you three see is Paul's future? And the last element that's left off this particular problem is a call to international norms, because there's an international side to cyber, which is why it's so hard to teach, mm-hmm. because you usually only have 14 weeks in a course or 12, and the four or five things I just ticked off are often courses onto themselves. So given the experience and brain power in this panel, Elizabeth, as a former dean, when you see and conceive of this issue that you articulated, what advice would you give people to how to wrap their minds around so we can educate the next, as we call, cyber core?
I guess I might offer a friendly amendment to your question,
okay.
And that is whether we ought to be seriously thinking about a redesign of the internet. We could have designed it differently than we did, and that would be really my add-on to your questions for the technology experts here.
Okay, so I hear
how Elizabeth passed this off so elegantly.
Okay.
It's very dean-like.
I hear that often, except in very minor ways I don't think would make any significant difference. The phrase highway robbery doesn't mean someone's stolen a piece of the road. When I work on network security, when I say tell people I work on network security, usually I'm lying because it's rarely the network itself. It's the end systems. Mm-hmm. It's the vulnerabilities in your web browsers and your web servers. Adobe Flash would be a serious security vulnerability in a completely redesigned internet. Any network of comparable power and the importance, the technical significance of the internet is as compared with the phone network, is that it put much more control in the hands of the end systems rather than what was in the middle. You know, the World Wide Web did not come out of the ISPs. It did not come out of a major corporation. It came out of one guy in a physics lab in Geneva who said, there's a better way to do this. And because every node on the internet could create something like this, like a web server, and you didn't require the cooperation of the ISPs. So there are a few things that I think should have been done differently on the internet, but for the most part, the problem is the software on the end systems. 20 years ago, I co-authored the very first book on internet security and firewalls, just when the internet was becoming big. And I still have a slide from a talk that I gave in May 1994, where I said the purpose of a firewall is to keep the bad guys away from the buggy code. The firewall is the network's response to the host security problem. I don't think there's anything that could have been done differently on the internet that would have saved us in any significant way from the problems we're seeing. A little bit when it comes to availability, which is certainly important, but from hacking into hosts, no, not at all.
Let me make two distinct points in response to that question, and in part in response to Steve. The first is that I worry a lot that at conferences like this we focus all on the bad of the network and its vulnerabilities. But it's precisely because it is so open to addition that the network has become of such great utility to everybody. Because nobody needs permission to add a web browser, that means that fundamentally the architecture of the network favors freedom. It's not an absolute, but it's one that drives innovation, entrepreneurship, and the massive plus up in economic value that has come from the network. I saw a study from the Hudson Institute a couple of weeks ago estimated that something between 17 and 25% of the growth in the last 10 years is tied to ICT technology in one way or another. That's an awful lot of benefit from us. So part of it is we don't want to kill the goose that lays the golden eggs just because of the cost of security. By adding too much to the network that deprives us of its flexibility. The other piece of it, which is also builds on what Steve said, is that it's exactly right to focus your influence points on the endpoints, the end users. Whether they're incentives or penalties depends upon your assessment of the mix. But what I think will drive the most successful sort of innovation going forward is a better definition of what reasonable security measures look like. Not absolute security measures, but reasonable ones. For example, this past year at DEF CON, at the Hacker Convention in Las Vegas, a group of security researchers released a 5-point plan for security in cars. And, some of its details that are beyond, our need. But one of the things was people who are designing cars should ensure that the operating systems for the brakes are separated from the non-essential systems like the computer that runs the radio. Because right now, they're not. And so if you hack in through an iPod plugged into the radio of the car to play iTunes through the speakers, it's easy for a malicious program to jump over and turn off the brakes, and you've converted it into a death machine. That's a simple solution. It requires some expense and redesign, but things like this are not beyond our capability of assessing. They're different for every technology, but they're not beyond our capability of assessing, and we should drive towards a solution where people who don't take that step are at least publicly shamed, if not penalized.
Thanks, Paul. Thanks for that anecdote. I'm sure many of us will be walking home now. So I guess I'm going to ask one last macro question. I'd like to open up to the audience because you've been very patient today. You've been listening, and I'm sure there are many things you may have. So the last question I have is that if you look at the panels across we've spent for the day, you see two sort of fundamental cultural divides. You've alluded to the fact that what really started the internet was a culture of openness. And individuals who basically wanted to be free and open and create something that didn't have a lot of state intervention. And then as we've moved through the last 10 or 15 years, there's been a deep feeling of wanting to have the states act in a way that responsibly protect their citizens. And that tension of the need for security from the state and the need for openness and creativity that has been generated by the internet are truly two different cultures. And Herb alluded to the fact, we haven't mentioned all the NGO entities that are so deeply involved that represent that first culture as opposed to the latter culture. And we're really in a struggle, those of us who work in this all the time, of how trying to resolve these extraordinary tensions. And the panel that was at the law said, look, there are laws out there. There's the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act. We've had courts. People have been following the law and doing what they believe were lawful acts. And as Harold Coe was used before, as alluded to, Harold always used to say, says, it might be lawful, but it might be awful. It will not be able to speak to what the deep values are of what we want to go forward for our grandchildren. And this is going to be a big issue as to what we do with the internet and how it's going to be either balkanized, or now what the phrase we used is Scotlandized. but apparently Great Britain won. Yay. So I know all of us are really deeply committed to that vote. So being from Quebec originally. So my sense is, given that big cultural issues, how does the panel see them resolving themselves? For you, it's going to be an FFRDC. I think for Steve alluded to, we'll have better ways of understanding what the technology should work. And for Paul, he's going to move into private practice.
Can I amend your sure. typology? And I mean, I have lots of answers, but I think you've left out, your description is incomplete.
Okay.
Because it posits that the forces of order and security are kind of unitary. I see this as a three-cornered struggle.
Okay.
There's the pure freedomish anarchistic internet origin groups of one form or another. There's the truly authoritarian reimposition of Westphalian sovereignty control type people, exemplified today by China, Russia, Iran, who want to not just provide security on the internet, but use it as a means of reasserting control over their civilian populations because of that. And then there's the liberal West that's kind of in the muddled middle, where we try and where we're of both minds, where Secretary Clinton can speak of the United States as favoring an internet freedom agenda at the almost exact same time that we now know other agencies of that same government were pursuing an agenda that some would say was inconsistent with that. And really, it's not that it's inconsistent, it's that it's trying to serve both masters at the same time. And as with so much, it's unsuccessful at it. But I think that we, right here, represent mostly that muddled middle that can't quite figure out how to do both things at the same time, can't walk and chew gum.
So Elizabeth, as one of the most eloquent spokespersons for the muddled middle, how do you see this?
Share some of your muddled thinking. Right. There's a wonderful book by Robert Cooper that I would recommend. It's called The Breaking of Nations. He was a British diplomat, and he talks about pre-modern, modern, and post-modern nations and how they're very different in the way in which they see how they relate to their citizens, the world generally. So we are not playing, this is a three-level chess game, I think, and I think we make a huge mistake in assuming that everybody cut their teeth on the principles of Jeffersonian democracy, and we will wave a wand and they will all be like us tomorrow. So that would be my first point. But my second point is that I think we have a really hollowed out, muddled middle. And I think our thinking is confused, even at a time when more and more pressures push us towards not a republic, but a direct democracy. That's certainly, I think, the thrust on the internet. Well, do a poll and find out what people understand about the government structure. Let's start at the basics, the three branches of government. What is an independent court system? Recently, there was a poll. Well, people thought an independent court system was synonymous with a runaway court system. And so when the California Chief Justice decided to impanel a group to look at some very fundamental things within the California judicial system, they didn't call it an independent judiciary. It was a commission on an impartial judiciary. So why is that happening? Well, we're not teaching civics. And I could go on, but you'd probably prefer that I stopped hectoring this particular group.
I don't think you have to hector the crowd.
You get
I've been
the
here
point,
all day,
though,
yes.
Right?
So, Steve, I'll give you the last word before we open up for questions. If it's three-level chess, then we need a Spock-like Vulcan as you know, in order to play in
with Steve.
And Steve, you're perfect. You're the most Vulcan like on the panel. So I'm going to give that to you.
I can try to stretch my ears a little pointy, but actually,
Nimoy was of the tribe.
Yes,
so,
yes, I know.
So what's your sense there?
One of the interesting reasons why the internet is so hard for governments to control, unless you take a very draconian approach like China has, is that it grew up in a deregulatory era and under the radar. So if you go back to the international telephone network and telegraph network, and by the way, one of my other diversions other than law from pure technology is history. Historian of cryptography. I've got some FOIA requests pending at the NSA right now. Thank you. The FOIA office seems to be rather busy with current events at the moment. I can't imagine why. If you wanted to set up a telegraph link between, say, the US and the UK, you needed a government charter from both sides. There are international record carriers. These are the approved international gateways. Well, the internet didn't grow up that way. And, you know, AT&T ran its links to Europe or to Asia. They didn't go through the same gateway that what's now Verizon's, but then UUnet, because no one cared. It's just a circuit. You can put it wherever you want to. And so the structure of the international networks do not correspond in any way to political boundaries. You know, this is why you can get packets from Europe to Africa going by way of the United States. It just happened to work that way in terms of the economics of it, not the legalities of it. From a technical perspective, we do not know how to build really secure systems, especially at an affordable price. And you know, my real technical goal is not how to secure a system. I don't have a big enough magic wand to do that, but to have one that doesn't fail catastrophically the way today's systems do. And we need that something that's good enough. We don't build, you know, we're not all driving around in armored Humvees with, you know, airbags on the bumpers to protect the cars. Absolutely, we look for something that's good enough. I don't like saying how much is a life worth, but if I have a certain number of dollars, how many lives can I save with it? And that's the way it is on the internet. How can I get a system that's secure enough not to give up the good things, as you talk about, but not to risk catastrophic failures? I'm not a believer in a digital Pearl Harbor for lots of reasons, but yeah, bad things can happen. It can cause serious inconvenience and economic loss at the least. And how do we minimize that at a rational outlay without giving up the good things that the internet gives us?
See, if I could probably get you a deal on up armored Humvee if you actually want one.
There's some excess
we have. Paul, do you want to go last before we open up? I'd like to know, after all this, like, do Dykus and Banks, based on this day, think they have to change our national security textbook? So I'd love to hear you guys. Maybe I invite you to the microphone to see what your reaction is.
This is a whole novel approach, asking the audience questions.
I was a law professor? Yes, okay. So,
I would just add that, you know, your question actually implicated one other kind of trend that is happening sort of under the radar, except for those of us on the inside, which is really the internationalization of the governance rules for the network. Traditionally, they've been set more or less by consensus, by a bunch of engineers who work at the Internet Engineering Task Force, and there's another group called ICANN, the Internet Corporation for Assigned Names and Numbers, which is a nonprofit organization. The battlefield for this fight that you've posited, Harvey, is going to be in those institutions. Here's the ultimate of lawyerly inside baseball, but it'll give you a flavor of it. The ICANN, the Internet Corporation for Assigned Names and Numbers, is a nonprofit corporation. It has a governmental advisory committee. And that's where the governments of the world get together and give it advice. And they're not privileged. They give advice in the same way that internet engineers give advice about what they think the right policy should be, and NGOs and everybody else has a place in this multi-stakeholder model. 2 weeks ago, ICANN proposed to actually change its bylaws so that it could not reject government advice unless 2/3 of the board voted to do so, which all of a sudden would convert the governmental advice to
mandate.
It wouldn't be a mandate, because obviously the really, really bad advice could be rejected. But if they get a one-third blocking majority on the board, governmental advice becomes governmental mandate. And all of a sudden, this institution, this little-known institution that has all sorts of authority over things like whether or not you can have freetibet.org will be under somebody else's control, maybe. And those are things that happen without anybody in this room noticing. And that's where the fight's really going
to
happen.
Okay. Can I invite people to the microphones for some questions? Zach's going to go first. I'll give him the privilege of sponsorship. Zach.
So one question I think is concerning to everybody, and that is the role of the ISPs. I perhaps should have asked this of Randy earlier this morning, but you know, the ISPs have some limited statutory authority to act to protect networks. But it seems that when you're thinking about ways to achieve effects at scale, minimum disruption and minimum cost, it's the ISPs that can really have the most bang for the buck. And so, you know, is that a discussion that
So there are two, from a technical perspective, there are two sides to that. On the one hand, the pure internet model says that they're just pure conduits, and they're not supposed to inspect or modify the traffic, which is what's necessary to do a lot of these things. And when they have the ability to do so, they seem inclined to do mischief, like inserting ads in web pages. There are plenty of examples, like the most recent allegations against Comcast's public wireless service. They do block things. They run the risk of blocking new technologies. Mm. Oh, what is this thing that runs on TCP port 80 that you're calling a web? What is this? From that perspective, you don't want them to have too much power. On the other hand, there's not a lot of profit in just being a bit pipe. It's a commodity business. We know what happens economically in a commodity business. Prices sink to the marginal cost, and they want to be value-added providers, but the more value they're adding, the more power they have for good and for bad. So there's tension in both directions. I tend more toward preferring the former. The ISP's not doing very much except maybe looking for viruses and email, though there's some fascinating legal questions there, like, does that mean if my ISP is scanning my email for viruses, does that mean I've given the content to a third party, and what does that mm-hmm. do to the Fourth Amendment? But courts have mostly tried to overlook that particular can of worms, for good reason, I might add.
I would say that from what I understand of the architecture, and I'm not nearly as conversant as Steve, they fit comfortably in what I would define as the least cost avoider under economic theory. And so I think that many of the issues that Steve raises are ones that could be addressed through legislation, regulation. They are already a regulated industry, more so than almost any other industry except the electric utilities in the United States. So it wouldn't be foreign to them. And it wouldn't be too much of a shift. And I think we could probably get a fair amount of positive value if we could answer some of the questions like passing a law that says it shall not be treated as a third party. Right now, I wouldn't want them to because there's too much uncertainty in the result. But it strikes me as if Congress were really serious about doing something positive about cybersecurity instead of fiddling about with information sharing bills that they don't ever pass, they could look at something like that.
You want to have a comment?
Yeah, I mean, in an ideal world, I think that is where you would go. But I think it will not play if legislation's required, as it probably will be, because it's too obscure an activity. And I think I would agree then with comments that Paul made that really pushing liability is likely to be a much stronger successful way to bring some of this into a more managed kind of structure. But when I say pushing liability, I'm not referring to the large infrastructure, secure infrastructure providers, but I really think more needs to be done looking at the individual member of the population, because I think increasingly they're going to come to realize that they've got a real, if you will, dog in this hunt, and that they are vulnerable and their children are vulnerable.
As you know, we said earlier about the private sector that when you think of the critical infrastructure, it's very heavily regulated once you parse out NERC and FERC and the finance. But as you're saying, the idea of using liability makes every trial attorney in this audience actually have their heart get warm to the idea that that's going to be a way that we're going to move forward.
And that is the way we have achieved, clumsy though it is, other kinds of policy reform.
As we pointed out, Ralph Nader became quite well known for being able to do that with that explosion. This man has been extremely patient, sir, who to say who you are and pose the question.
Good afternoon. My name is Norman Chung. I'm with a technology provider, Presidio Network Solutions. I have a question for the panel. I guess in terms of the technology world, there's so much entropy in terms of all the innovation and all the product development that's going on. And as you alluded to, the Internet of Things and certain industry movements such as software-defined networks will introduce additional elements of uncertainty and lead to unintended developments and unanticipated consequences. One of the things is that we all talk about is network situational awareness in the industry. And that is something that is very poorly understood in the public domains and in the political executives. What can be done to increase people's network situational awareness so that when things such as the Internet of Things is discussed, that the proper controls and the proper governance mechanisms can be applied to them so that they don't result in unintended catastrophes?
You want to go ahead? This is, Steve, like many of us, we sit on corporate boards.
You're asking that question in a country where, you know, half the people don't know who the Chief Justice of the United States is. I mean, it's an educational problem, really. And it's not an education at the collegiate level. When I talk about this, I often talk about my grandchildren who are, I think indoctrinated is a fair way to say it, about environmental matters, because they've learned it since kindergarten. And if I make the mistake of throwing a Coke can in the garbage instead of the recycle, they yell at me. We need to start talking about networks and security and things like that. Yeah, and obviously network situational awareness is not for kindergarten, but good cyber hygiene, don't click on the link, is, and then, you know, I think it's an essential component of everybody's education.
And, you know, I was actually saying to Harvey I wanted to make a comment, and it was along those lines.
Sorry.
No, not at all. If we're teaching them coding at younger and younger ages, what else are we teaching them? We ought not just be teaching technical skills, but technical skills in a social context. And I think that's where we have gone wrong again and again. I could extrapolate into other areas as well. We bring scientists over here. There's little effort put into making sure they understand the context in which much of what we've done from a technical perspective has been successful. And so I think similarly, going back to the entire educational process, that's got to happen.
Absolutely. A few years ago, I created an undergraduate course in computers and society, and one of my PhD students, who grew up in China, went to college in Singapore, was appalled that there wasn't already such a course. It was a required freshman course when she went to college, that you had to understand the ethics implications of societal context. But the situational awareness, it's hard technically. How could a company the size and sophistication of Home Depot not know for 5 months that their credit card and payment systems had been completely, thoroughly, and totally owned, as the saying goes? So there's a technical problem. They're just noticing what's going on. There's also a human interface problem. A lot of security software is really horribly unusable by even geeks, let alone normal people. There's a classic paper from 20 years ago called Why Johnny Can't Encrypt. There's a follow-on
recently. Isn't it a
recently,
film now? It's not a film
about
now?
The secure radios that police and law enforcement use, which subtitle was Why Special Agent Johnny Can't Encrypt. It's situational awareness. How do you present the information to the average citizen in a way that is comprehensible and actionable? And that's a really difficult problem. There are too few computer scientists who have the practical training in applied psychology and human-computer interaction to get this right. I've got a book manuscript, and one of the things I did was take an analysis of some of the security warnings that popular browsers give, and they're completely and totally incomprehensible. Even Apple's, and they're the company that seems to get it right more than most.
Yeah, I actually have to tell this story. I teach a cybersecurity law and policy class at GW, and a couple of years ago, based on this, why Johnny can't encrypt, I made it a mandate that my students take my PGP public key and send me an encrypted message. And at the time, I thought that this was just, you know, an exercise that would teach them how to install, you know, some PGP, some easy to use, something like Mailvelope or whatever. I had to make that no longer a requirement, but just an exercise for that, because half of the class, all of whom are, you know, law students, graduate students, could not figure out how to do it. And so if I actually made it a, you must do this to pass the class, I'd have failed half my class, which would have really made the dean very unhappy.
Think I dare do that with my students.
Yeah, no, so I literally just on the way up here, I did it again for this year's class, but I had a little note, this is not mandatory. Yeah, this is an exercise for you to try and experiment. And I will report back to you all, but out of the 40 students in the class, I'm going to guess that maybe 10 will do it. And of those, 7 will do it only because they already have, you know, the chops and PGP enabled somewhere on one of their browsers, and that'll be that.
So C.P. Snow wrote a book many years ago called Two Cultures. That the evolution is that the problem was we were going into it like geeks and wonks, and that those two cultures would have a big impact on our democracies. So the other issue is to the question, when I started at Harvard, the most popular course for undergraduates was the Introduction to Government. And then while I was there, it switched to Introduction to Economics. And now the most popular undergraduate course at Harvard is Introduction to Computers. There's been an incredible switch among the undergraduates of where they see where power lies and what careers are. But to your point, which was your question, Suzanne Spaulding, who's with DHS, has asked the ABA to ask whether or not we can encourage the ABA governance section for corporations to make it a requirement when you have a takeover, we do extensive audits on the financial capacity of the corporation you're acquiring. And Goldman Sachs has extraordinary amounts of checklists that they do for the acquisition. But they do not have a checklist for what is the security of your network computer system. So she's asking us, if you want to get corporate America to be focused, make it a requirement in their acquisitions that there must be a due diligence on what kind of computer networks you have and how many penetrations you've had and what is the IT security. And that would be another way to focus the real world on why that's significant. It would be a very simple change, but just think of the impact it might have inside our corporate cultures. Ma'am, you've been very patient.
Yeah, I think it follows really nicely with what you just said. Can you hear me?
Yes, talk a little bit closer to the mic.
So I think...
Who are you?
I'm Seda Gursis. I'm a postdoc computer scientist at NYU.
And great. Thank you.
Basically, one of the things we're seeing in the security industry is exactly kind of a switch from a detection-oriented security agenda or a paradigm to a prevention prediction, which means that instead of kind of locking in the classical, you know, way of designing security, making the walls very strong, what you do is you surveil everything that's going around it to look for anomalies and detect attacks before they happen. This is also economically much more interesting. You can go up to your boss and say, I had very thick walls, therefore there were no attacks. It's very hard to prove, but you can go up to your boss and say, I caught like 72 odd looking guys. I think they were gonna attack our system. That looks much more effective. Now, what is also a part of this kind of security game is deception. So on the one hand, the attackers will want to deceive the detection systems, and at the same time, DARPA is putting a lot of money into using deception both for security and to attacks. Deception, just for those who don't know, is basically creating a lot of noise that would either, you know, bypass the usual schemes that would be looking for certain patterns, or just creating a lot of noise. What does it mean to build a cybersecurity that is mainly based on more surveillance and more deception? And what does that mean for the legal system? Thank you.
Great question. So, Paul.
That's a good question.
That's clearly something that's in your...
Yeah, no, it's a fantastic question, and the real reason is because it runs, I think, square into and is inconsistent with existing legal paradigms. Steve was talking about whether or not Verizon would be able to read his mail and the packets as he inspected. That's part of that surveillance paradigm. You know, I always remind my students that you know that means all the information, including the medical records or the political speech. One of the classic hacks, you know, of the Dalai Lama involved a list of the supporters of freetibet.org, which the Supreme Court has said in an American context is a protected free speech, protected document, NAACP versus Alabama. Membership lists are not disclosable. So in our context, it means one of two things. It either means that we cannot have governments responsible for the security, that it has to be privatized in some way, which gets back to my liability point, or it means we're going to have to fundamentally change our conception of what powers we feel comfortable giving the government. In today's world, post-Snowden, the latter of those is a dim prospect. Whether you think it should or not, just as a predictive matter, not happening this century. And I know we're only in 2014, so that's 86 years of prediction you got there. So it's going to have to, it runs square into our paradigms. We call deception fraud, right? And that's a crime. You know, we call surveillance spying, and it's not allowed against Americans. So what you described, which is a completely accurate description of best practices and the way we're going, is utterly, fundamentally at odds with what we currently think of as good things for governments to do, or even people.
But Paul, I'm not sure she was talking about a government as the actor.
No, not necessarily. I mean, but so what I think the implication is it can't be government, right?
Well, yeah, obviously it cannot. But what about the private sector? How do you feel about that?
So, we're going to have to let the government, we're going to have to, I mean, fraud is even a private sector problem, right? So we're going to have to exclude it somehow and find a definition of fraud that doesn't include deception.
Oh, I think she's talking about deceiving the attackers.
Not everybody that you deceive is necessarily an attacker.
Well, right? I guess the issue here, maybe some clarity, is that this is, as you know, this became a hot topic called active defense.
Mm-hmm.
The argument being if the networks and the government have failed to protect the entity, entities need to respond. So in our playbook for cyber events, that's in the back if you want to get, we devoted a whole chapter to the concept of active defense. And we like to call it a comprehensive cyber response. And the argument would be that if, when you're in your network, there's a great deal of legal capacity when someone is in your network. And you have a great deal of latitude to cleanse the network and deal with those type of issues. Once you start leaving your network and going out, it becomes a little bit less clear what you can lawfully do. And we had members from the Department of Justice as part of the working group for them to make it very clear that the government in general doesn't like the idea of a self-appointed posse that then does its own capacity to find the criminal because there's not enough bandwidth for the government, so they have to use the private sector. But if the government deputizes the entity, which is what a posse is, then that entity then has the immunity to start taking actions. And there's a whole range of issues from can you have a digital watermark? Can you have a beacon sounding on the data so that it comes back? So you can have something in that data that if it's opened up in an unlawful manner, it can create a more destructive impact. All of those range of issues are what people have been talking about because they thought has been the failure of being able to protect. And it goes back to our original question of what is the appropriate role for the government? What's the appropriate role for the private sector? What's the appropriate role for the international system? Keeps on coming back as a theme inside these issues.
Can I make one quick point?
Absolutely.
Which is, To the woman whose question this was, what we need from you is help in defining the technically relevant questions. Because Harvey has just said, on network, my network is good, off my network, not as good. I know, because I know enough about it, to know that the line between my network and not my network is fuzzy. And I need your help and his help in helping to decide whether a persistent VPN is on my network or off my network. And the line, actually, we just need to know what the questions are, because we can draw an arbitrary line, and then everybody will conform. But technologists need to tell us the relevant technology so that we can understand the questions and translate them into legal prose, and then we can define what's on and off.
So I'm going to assert my role as chair, because David Graham has a ferry to take, and he made it very clear to me that this must end at 4:15. And David has been one of the members of the lawyer Jurga, and therefore we have to make sure that all tribal members feel comfortable with their commitment to the system. So, sir, you get the last question of the entire day, and I encourage you, when you answer the question,
to be brief.
Okay. In your case, whatever. But I think the issue is to be answer the question and give your final remarks, so that we'll round it up and finish exactly at 4:15. Sir. Okay.
Yeah, my name's Ronald McGuire. I'm a civil rights attorney, and the last question and your response and Steve's comments before just prompted a concern I have about privacy, and also a concern that I have about Steve's comment about when he compared this to the advent of the telephone. And haven't we been here before? And I guess, I think I might be missing something in the conversation now, because it seems that the same argument for a lack of privacy could have been applied to the Bell system at a time when the Bell system was a private company that was transmitting privileged speech.
Sure.
And at that time, it was intuitively obvious to everybody, even though it was a time of regulation, that it was speech and it was protected.
So actually, it wasn't.
I think the question, which I'll give to Thais, as you know, it raises for us in this arena the constitutional questions about third-party doctrine, and what we've known as versus the content of something versus the macro data issue. So it's a perfect question to end the day. Thank you. Privacy, ma'am.
Well, yeah. I'm currently serving on a National Academies of Science study that Herb Lin is staffing, and we're looking at the president's PDD 28. And there are two lawyers, and the rest are computer scientists. And we have been looking at, frankly, this whole range of issue. It is quite clear that, Smith versus Maryland, the third party case, is an interesting one to think about. Because for two reasons. One is a difference in degree can certainly become a difference in kind, but there's also the debate that, whatever macro or metadata, should say, was, it wasn't a term used when Smith was decided, isn't metadata quite different today, and can you define what metadata is so that it's consistent with the way in which it was conceived of in Smith? And I think there the answer is yes, you can, and that is the way it's been handled by the government. But that still leaves unresolved, and this is a question I think that cuts across all of these issues, is there something different qualitatively about any of the activities we're talking about because of their very size? I'll end by saying that I think all of us agree that what we've seen in the way NSA has handled this is 180 degrees out from the way the privacy community responds. And yet, there's clearly the issue that people worry about, it once was handled badly, might it not be at some point in the future? And so once again, we look at systems and we say we want zero risk. And I don't think zero risk in any of the things we're talking about is realistic. We've got to have some way to sort through these issues and set the tolerance level for the risk we're willing to take for the systems we need at a sensible level.
Stephen.
Yeah. For all that I've written about privacy in the Fourth Amendment and technology and so on, I often worry more about the private sector, which is not constrained by the Fourth Amendment or in this country by very many statutes. You know, if we can get reasonable, from my perspective, court rulings on reasonable expectation of privacy or what have you, I will be a lot less worried because, you know, there is recourse. There isn't when a Facebook, a Google, a Twitter, whomever starts collecting large amounts of data and using it who knows how. You know, by the way, I don't agree that phone calls were protected. It was obvious. It was the Olmstead case, what, 24 or so, which said you did not need, 26, you did not need a warrant under Olmstead to wiretap a phone call. It wasn't until Katz in 1967 that was changed. So we had quite a long time when phone calls were not protected under the Fourth Amendment. And we don't understand yet what is, you know, it's metadata all the way down. It's turtles all the way down. It's, I can make a very strong case technically that, say, the pen register statute as applied to the internet is just technically incorrect in many ways. I think defining it would be a very hard problem, but it's something about the conversations, who you call rather than the call itself. It can be very revealing in many cases. I actually have another law review paper which talks about location privacy when machine learning algorithms, the classic big data algorithms, can make accurate enough predictions, predictions about things that are not directly observed. I'll give you one example. 6 weeks worth of monitoring who calls whom. I'm sorry. 6 weeks of monitoring location data turns out to be let you predict fairly accurately somebody's ethnicity. This is not obvious why it should be. Right. Nevertheless, there's experimental evidence saying 6 weeks I can get about 60%, 65% accuracy of what your ethnicity is.
I guess it's the movement from causality to correlation, which is
giving
us a
better... It is
correlation.
Thank you for that. Last word, sir.
Two quick points. The first is I think that the transformation that is being wrought by large-scale data analytics is actually something new. I think it's not just more of the same.
Correct.
It's something different. It's the ability to see the mosaic where we did not have that ability before. And so I think that all of our privacy laws and concepts about use limitations and collection limitations were written at a time when we had a completely different understanding. To say that doesn't mean that I know what to replace it with, only to say that I know that the current system is inadequate to the task. And the last point I would make, which is pretty fundamentally about everything that I think you've heard today, is that the more I study this area, the more convinced that there's less that I know. That everything changes so quickly, so dynamically. I learn something every day I always end my, you know, end these talks with an admonition to humility. We live in a world where 10 years ago Facebook didn't exist, and today there's a billion users. Mm. And I predict that 10 years from now, Facebook will not exist in any form recognizable to us today. And I'm quite confident of that, but I have no idea what form it will look like. And that's the problem, is we're writing a script on a page that turns so fast that we don't know what's happening next. And that means that we should be very cautious about firm rules and very open to adaptational rules.
So I can't thank you enough for the question, because it's a perfect transition, because we're going to be gathering. The Lawyer Jurga is going to be ending. We're gathering in Oklahoma with Joshua Snavely next year. And he's going to be focusing on the creation of the Homeland Institute. And the notion of privacy and big data is probably going to be one of the central themes that we're going to have to focus on. So with that, I want to give particular thanks to this man right here and NYU for putting together an incredible event. I can't thank you enough for staying to the end. And travel safe, and obviously don't take the car to go home. Thank you.